This presentation that I'll be doing is titled, I believe, R&B, Funk, and Pop Saxophone Styles. So I'm going to be talking about how players approach those musics and how they improvise over those different grooves and styles. I could include other styles along with that, smooth jazz, soul jazz, Motown. So if we think about, well, why do we group all of these different styles together and sort of lump them all together, and how can we talk about them in a general sense all together? Does anybody have any ideas about that? What do they have in common? So I think of this as sort of like the R&B sort of lineage, the umbrella of R&B music and all the different branches that R&B took. So let me play you a couple of examples of some of the players who are playing, you know, different styles. And we're talking, you know, styles that started as early as the 1940s into the 1950s and just sort of developed and evolved into different threads. So here's a couple of different examples. Just some short excerpts. Okay, so now you heard some of these varying styles, and they're varying styles, and they're also varying time periods. You know, like some recordings were from the 60s, some recordings from this decade. So any ideas now? What do we hear that might be in common with all of these styles?
It's like a mixture of flash and taste at the same time.
Okay, well, I like that. That's great. Yes? Okay. Altissimo is definitely a feature, like sort of a characteristic that's really common to these styles, yes? Absolutely. Well, and some of them are rhythmic in different ways, yeah?
Well, like the tone, like a lot of them are like growling, like.
Okay, good. And we're going to touch on all of this. Very good. Yeah. I'm sorry? The blues. Be specific, if you can just narrow it down slightly. The blues, what? Okay, so that is the essential ingredient. The blues scale is common to all of these styles and is the predominant, not the only by any means, material that the players are using. Whether it's, you know, the melodies of the songs, the heads, or the improvisation material. So that's like a huge, huge element. And you know, it seems simple enough. Blues scale. Everybody here know a blues scale, pretty much? And yet, these guys, you know, they work with it all their lives, and they develop it to a pretty sophisticated, you know, what they can do with it becomes endless. And the tasty ways they can manipulate it and the melodies they can create. So I just want to talk about the blues scale. Let's start with that. And let's take a look at it. Okay, so here's a D blues scale, and you probably all already know this, but the formula is, if we compare it with a major scale, it's the root, or one, and then the flat third. So like instead of an F sharp of a D major scale, it's the F natural. The four, G, the flat five, A flat, the five, and the flat seven. Okay, so It's a six-note scale. There's already some notes missing. There's no second note, second degree. There's no sixth degree. So, and each note has like its own personality, like its own characteristic within the scale itself. So clearly, the D, the one, is your home note. Okay, so that's kind of like your resolution note. So let me just play you the scale. So the D, we hear it as, so the final resting point. So it's home. All the other notes pretty much have a tendency of eventually, at sooner or later, wanting to go home. So when you improvise with this scale, you really want to hear that, and that's sort of like your resolution point to when you create a phrase. Within that, each note sort of has its own characteristics. So the flat three, so it's very has a very strong pull back to the root. It's one of your bluesiest notes in the scale. You can hear how it wants to resolve down. The four is kind of like a color note. But still wants to travel down. The flat five is the dramatic note. Okay, that's the most dissonant note. It's the bluesiest note. It's really the most important note in terms of blues. So it's not a note that you want to just hold on to. It nearly needs to resolve, and yet you can really milk that note and create much, you know, really a bluesy sound with it. The natural five is almost as stable as the root. So it almost feels like we could end a phrase on the five. And then the flat seven, again. So it also wants to resolve to the root, but it almost has a greater tendency to resolve up rather than down. So that's a really important thing to kind of like, what I recommend is that you just sit there and play around with the scale. You know, like the lonely saxophonist, you know, playing the blues with nothing else, you know, so that you just get the sense of this scale in and of itself. One thing I'll mention about using the scale is that it sounds really good if you just play it up and down, as I've done so far. You don't necessarily have to skip around a lot. In fact, don't forget, it's got two skips. And if we skip more, it adds, there's a tendency that it can sound sort of random, okay? And there are good skips to do, tasty skips that work. But if I play, it's hard for me to do that. It doesn't really make a lot of sense. If I play, right? That all of a sudden sounds really, really good. And I didn't do anything. I just played down the scale. So that's a really important thing to remember. Lots of times when we're improvising, we're trying to be creative. But we have to realize that the scale does a lot of it for us. And if we just able to execute, you know, it's not even that easy, you know, to play the scale and have that kind of knowledge and that flexibility with it to play it. Just to play it that way, you do have to practice. So it's not like you're doing nothing. You have to have a really good command of the scale to even play it. It's, in some ways, it's almost harder to play it in order. Now you can change direction anytime. You know, so that always sounds good, but just going in order is a sure bet. So I mentioned that. So what I'd like to do now is talk a little bit about the blues. So I've talked about the blues scale, but now the blues. The blues is not the blues scale. So if I say, hey, let's play a blues, what am I saying? Progression. Tell me more. What? Yes. It's a song form, exactly. And what is that form? Okay. First thing I want to know if I'm going to play it is, how long is it? 12 bars, okay? So 12 bar blues, and it has a set chord progression. Let's take a look at that. Now, the reason I like to talk about the blues is because while we're going to be talking about these other styles like funk and so on, the blues is really the basis for all of this music, of rhythm and blues. And even pop music, any commercial music, the blues is really the basis for that. So where'd it go? So here's the progression, which you just mentioned, that's got the Roman numerals, the one chord going to the four. I'm not going to get too much into that, you know, in terms of the theory of it. The most important thing that we know is it's 12 bars long. And what happens at the end of 12 bars? We just repeat it. So, you know, you could have a performance of a blues that repeats 20 times. You know, if everyone takes a solo, you know, or so we just keep going around and around and around, but everybody knows what to do because we're playing this form, this 12-bar form with this set chord progression. So now if we think about playing the blues scale over this, in addition to each note having its own characteristic, now we've got harmony underneath, okay? We've got different chords moving. And so the notes really take on new sound and new flavor for every chord changes. So let's say I hold the D, and I'm holding D, and I'm the first measure, then I come to the second bar, and it's a G7 chord. That D is not going to sound the same. I mean, yeah, it's still a D, but the supporting harmony is going to make it sound different. So let me... So before, I demonstrate that, let's just talk about a few things that are really important. If you're going to play to anything, whether it's a backing track or a live band, and you're improvising, what's the most important thing? The most important thing is that you don't get lost. So, a lot of times players, they launch into a solo, but they're not hearing the form. So the first thing you want to be able to hear is, where is one? Where is the downbeat of every measure? So you just want to be able to count to yourself, one, two, three, four, and have it line up. So do that in your head. One, two, three, four, one, two. Is that agreeable? Pretty much, okay? If you're not sure, then it's just a question of listening. And you can listen to recordings, you know, of great players, or just backing tracks. You know, a lot of these play-alongs, we launch into playing all the time, but you can just listen. And the more you hear, the more creative, the better your playing will be. Second most important thing that you want to be able to hear is the beginning. So we've got these 12 bars that go over and over and over. But where are we now? Can anyone tell me when we come back to the beginning? Beautiful, okay? So when you're playing, you know, it's one thing to listen and get it, which is great. But when you're playing, it's real easy to get like into your playing. And you're not listening. So in addition to everything that you're doing, scales, whatever you're thinking, chords, licks, keep listening to the band, okay? Don't let them out of your sight. The last thing that's really important, and once you get this, you've really got pretty much everything, is hearing the beginning of each four-bar phrase. So we have, basically, you can see, three four-bar phrases. You want to hear the beginning of each phrase. So if I were to... So here's the top. So it's kind of a big chord change at that point. Here we go. Four chord. Last four bars. Okay. So now I'm just going to play with the blues scale a little bit. So So what you want to do to get like a sense of each of the notes and like its meaning here is just take one note at a time. Listen to the chords. So now I'm on the flat 3. 4. And you can just hold it for like a whole bar. A whole chorus, just to get like, even though it won't sound right all the time. So there's that flat 5. Now if I hold that all the time, sounds pretty weird, you know. But it gives me a sense, okay, well that note sounds weird if I hold it all the time. The natural 5. Flat 7. Okay. So that's a really good way to get a sense of each of the notes and how to, the more you're hearing each note, the more you can play off. And meanwhile, you know, you're hearing the form, you're hearing where you are at all times. Okay, cool. So let's, the next thing I want to talk about is I introduced the presentation as about R&B, funk, and pop. What are we doing right now? What style is that? It's blues. It's 12-bar blues, but what is the groove? Swing, okay? So, exactly. So we hear the ride cymbal. Okay, that's a swing groove. Okay, so other than the fact that the blues is 12 bars long and it has a set chord progression, it can be anything at all, okay? It can be any groove. We could have the BSO, Classical Symphony Orchestra, playing the blues. So I want to play for you some different grooves, but these are all still blues. So for example, so this is called a boogaloo. It's an even eighth note groove, right? So it's all the same stuff applies. Okay. So here's another one. So that's kind of, that was like in the 70s that first started. This is Green Onions. You know Green Onions? Cool. So, but this is like, it's almost like a shuffle. This one has a swing feel. So you can have a lot of more like, R&B type grooves that still have swing feel, because hip hop, for that matter, a lot of it has a swing groove. So the swing in and of itself doesn't mean it's jazz. What do we have here? Ah. Right? Okay, so here's a real nasty funk. Still a blues. Okay, so you get the idea on that. Okay, so let's one thing I want to sort of add to the mix is that while I can use the D blues scale, I can also use another blues scale. Ooh, another blues scale. Is anybody aware of this? It's the same formula blues scale, it's just a different key. And I can use it all over a blues. So like, mostly if we're talking major blues. Minor blues and minor keys are a little bit different. I'll talk about those in a sec. So over a D blues, I can also play a B blues scale. So it's the same exact formula scale, 1 flat 3, 4 flat 5, 5 flat 7. The two scales, so are you familiar with like major and relative minor? So the relative minor is based off the sixth degree of the major scale. Same concept here. So this is based off the sixth degree of like a D major scale. So the two scales have three notes in common. They have three notes that are different. So we have a total of 9 notes now. So the notes they have in common are D, F, and A. So 1, 3, 5 of a D minor triad. So I just wanted to give you an example of like what this sounds like. The scale based on six is much more major sounding. It's less bluesy. It's more inside the key. There are fewer notes that clash. The really big feature of this is the F sharp. So if I'm in a D major blues, I have F sharp now, which is the major third of the key. Before, I just had the F natural. So let me give you an example. So I'm just going to play with six. In doing this yourselves, what you want to do is, once you figure out which other, so blues scale, you want to learn in 12 keys, right? Ideally, because you never know what key someone will call or, you know, what tune you're going to be playing on. And it also gives you this flexibility of being able to use the two scales, which gives you a lot more variety. So what you do is, with the six bass scale, just learn the scale and then try using it. And you really want to force yourself to only use the six, this scale, because then you'll figure out how it works. So D is still home, even though it's a B scale. I'm in the key of D, so D is home. So it's really nice to kind of bounce off the B back to the D. That's the B. So it's still D. D is still home. And they all have similar relationships to D. You know, they have their own characteristics. And so let me play a little bit, and then I'll contrast it with going to the D scale. B still. Here's D. So now I'll go to D. So you may have trouble hearing the difference. I kind of tried to hammer on the F sharp for the B and on the A flat for the D, because, you know, those are probably the two biggest differences between the two scales. So both scales work. So it's going to sort of sound the same. But as you experiment yourselves, you'll hear, oh, wow, big difference, big difference. OK, so let's talk a little bit.
Get up, we'll
hear it. Yeah. OK, so what I'd like to do now is talk about, so I've kind of given you an idea of how to use the scale, right? So you can, using it up and down sounds really, really good without skips. You got the D scale, the B scale. But we all know there are licks, right? There are licks, and I kind of don't like the the term licks, because I like to think of it more as the language, because there are certain things that people play which are part of the language. And you don't only want to play those, but licks are good for a couple of reasons. One, they give your playing kind of an authenticity, like you're kind of connecting with the players of the past, the good players, the great players. If you kind of steal or borrow some of them. A lot of these blues licks, they're very generic. They're not specific to one player because everybody uses them. There are others that are specific. The other reason that they're really good to learn is they give you the sense of how to use the scale. You know, because they're really successful ways that the scale is played in. So if you learn licks, you get the idea, oh yeah, this sounds really good doing it this way. Now I can do it a little bit different maybe, you know, and take off from that. So I just wanted to show you a few licks as such. So these are using the D blues scale, but sometimes we borrow notes from the two scales. So when I just demonstrated the blues scales, the two right now, I kept them completely separate, which is a very effective way to do it, and that's the way a lot of players use them. There are, however, some licks which combine some of the different notes. So you can integrate the two scales in different ways. So this first lick, it comes down the D blues scale and then turns up to that F sharp. So borrowing that F sharp from the B scale. You probably heard that kind of sound. Right? Sounds kind of familiar. Others, like two, very simple. Let me play through them. The next one has the F sharp as well. The last, number five, is another triplet one. You know, so repeating ideas are cool. You know, just like repeating a short phrase. This one, number seven, is like used a lot as like an intro or an ending. Right? So that one's cool. You know, that's a little trickier, more complex. And you can see that uses the skips going up to the D each time. The next one, eight, starts off the same way that number four did, with this chromatic F, F sharp, G, A flat to A natural. So this one's cool though, because it's a six note phrase, and yet we're playing it in 16th notes, four note groupings. So when you put it against the groove, it kind of keeps shifting, downbeat, upbeat, downbeat, upbeat. This next one. That one just goes down the scale. So I'll try to incorporate some of these in my playing. So I actually compiled like a whole bunch of these. Yikes. Yes, copies are at the door on your way out. So. For a price. No, just kidding. Okay, so let me play you a couple of these. So here's the first. Now, when I go to the four chord, I don't want to play F sharp, because the four chord is a G7, has an F natural. So if I play that F sharp too hard on the four chord, your ears will tell you. That's one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. sharp as a passing tone, no problem. Someone mentioned growling earlier.
I did.
Yes, he gets extra credit for that. Okay, so let's just talk about some of these. So how many growlers do we have? Okay, so we have some growlers, some not so growlers. Okay, so growling. Right, so what am I doing? Growlers, please help us out here. Humming. I'm humming and blowing. Not something I normally do, okay? So we usually push air through the horn or we sing, but we don't usually do both things at the same time. So for those of you who are growlers, how did you learn to growl? Somebody, like, was it hard trying to figure it out in the beginning or? You were doing it wrong? Wait a minute. I'm hearing something. Do that again. Okay, he's got a rare talent. We'll talk about that in a minute. Do you know what that is? Okay. Can you get your saxophone out? Okay. So basically all I'm doing is, this is some steps towards doing it. So basically what you want to do is blow a steady, hard stream of air and hum. Okay? That's in and itself strange. Just getting the coordination of it. Then you can get on, very good. Now you can get on the saxophone and you blow air. I'm pushing air through the horn, but not enough to actually get a note. And then I just increase the air, but I try to keep the hum. Start with hum. So when you try to do this, the tendency is that the hum stops as soon as you get a note. Because you're used to playing the saxophone, and you're used to, you can hang there. You don't have to come up. Oh. Yeah, ouch. Yeah. Just, yeah. So that's what you want to do, is just try it in these steps. The next thing is bending. So bending is probably the most important thing, because if I just play the scale, you know. Right? So, but if I. That's everything, right? We really need that to create the blues quality. So bending is a really hard thing to describe. It's kind of like. It's some of it's with the mouth, but the majority of it is more with the throat. Okay, so it's sort of the back of your throat. It's like sort of a yawning feeling. One of the best ways to learn how to bend is just to hear it. Hear somebody doing it, have a recording or something, and then just try to produce it. Have the sound so strong in your ear of what you want to hear that you just keep trying to do it, and eventually it'll just happen. It's better than trying to. Because it's not something that we can really control in that sort of conscious way. So I'm especially talented at this, so. So I can just, I'm just not moving my fingers. So it's just with my throat that I do that. So bending's a huge thing. So you can bend up. or down. So the down's really nice. Warble. Okay, so warble. So the warble is if you finger E flat, okay, E flat with the octave key, and then you take off your G finger, and with your mouth, sounds like a French police car or something. So, okay, and then just power a lot of air. And that one's old. That one goes back to like Dexter Gordon and even earlier. So that's a cool one for bluesy sound. Vibrato is really a very important expressive device for all styles of music, right? So it's done with the jaw, and you just want to practice that so you get control of it. Articulation. Articulation is, of the two of the list here, articulation and bending are the two most important. Articulation doesn't sound exciting, but it's so key. You know, if you're doing like an eighth note line, jazz articulation, where I'm tonguing upbeats, how many of you are familiar with jazz articulation? Okay. So it's not the swing, because I can do it without swing. So I'm still doing the articulation, even though the eighth notes are even, straight eighth notes. With triplets, it's nice to like do slur two and tongue one. Or even tonguing every note. So articulation is something that takes years to really perfect, to get so light and connect the notes really as much as you can with and still tongue. So a good thing to do is to just to play like middle C. Most articulation is your tongue's coming up from the bottom of your mouth and hitting the edge, the tip of the reed, and not the tip of your tongue, but you know, maybe an eighth, quarter of an inch back. So taking one note and seeing how much you can connect that note, how smooth you can make it, is a really good test. Keep the air going as though it's a whole note. Like you're just playing one note, the air doesn't know you're tonguing, you know? And then, you know, you can do short staccato. So you can have hard attacks, soft attacks, all of that. The next one on the list is glissando. So glissando is a cousin of bending. So glissando is when we go up the horn, but it's sort of like that smear sound, where we don't hear each note, you know? So basically what I'm doing is I have all the notes bent. So I'm bending as I go. I'm in a sort of like a constant state of bending and then just sliding my fingers off. Okay, it's kind of weird. I can kind of go down too. So Johnny Hodges, you guys know Johnny Hodges? Yeah, so Johnny Hodges played with Duke Ellington. And this was kind of his trademark. He would play ballads and he would play up these notes. You never kind of knew where he was going to go with it. And then he would come bend it down. He could bend it just smoothly all the way down, without seamlessly. So that's a lot of fun to play around with. Tremolo. So tremolo is like a trill. Yes. Yep.
You know the song Star-Crossed Lovers?
I do, yeah.
When he does that,
right.
Part, yeah.
That's a good one. Passion Flower, yeah. Especially on slow tunes, ballads, he would do that. And it's very evocative. Okay, so altissimo. So you all know, I mean, we mentioned altissimo, right? So I can take an altissimo and bend it. And the altissimo is really nice. You know, it's really, really effective and a lot of fun. Watch out. Don't get too into trying to do altissimo. Make sure your sound, yes. On alto, I don't go too high. Like on tenor, I play like up to like E. So like maybe so you have your high D. So I can go like an octave, a little more than an octave above that. You know. But alto is probably about B, maybe C sometimes. Yeah, for me. So with this, you know, so you really want to get really, really solid sound. Make sure you're breathing right, your tone is good, you know, before you start to embark on those really altissimo notes. Because a lot of you probably want to get up there, get into the altissimo. So take your time, make sure, you know. And, you know, then you can try it. If it doesn't work, back off from it, practice, come back and try it some more. You guys have private teachers, some of you, most of you? Okay, so you know it's really good to be guided by your private teacher on that. All right, so we have our guest artist today. He's going to demonstrate for us flutter tonguing. For flutter tongue, it's like the growl. You're playing normally, and you get the flutter tongue going at the same time. Have you tried? Can you do it? Great. So that's used in these styles, especially more like in Motown, soul, R&B styles like that. So I'll play you an example of a famous recording. So let's take a look at the solo and listen to it at the same time. Nasty kind of sound, really bright. And that's often the case that the tone of players who play in all these various styles tends to be much, much brighter than we have in jazz, in straight ahead jazz. And it's because of the instruments that you're trying to blend with. So with straight ahead jazz, you're playing more with acoustic instruments, right? Acoustic piano, acoustic bass. Whereas this music and all the various styles that we've talked about, more electric, okay? Electric guitars, a lot of amplification. So you really need a bright sound to cut through. Okay, split tones. Split tones are really cool. It's like getting sort of a multiphonic. And you're kind of getting the octave below, and it's that dirty, dirty sound. So it's kind of another thing you can add to the mix. You got the growling, you got the flutter tongue, and split tones. The other effect that I didn't talk about was subtone. So subtone, how, you guys know subtone? Right, so straight tone. Subtone. So I'm not just playing softer. I can play subtone pretty loud. So subtone is where I back off and I hardly have any mouthpiece in my mouth. I'm very, very loose and I'm blowing like hot air, like that kind of air. And my lip, I got a lot of lip on the reed. Your horn really has to be in good shape. If you have leaks, trying to do it on these low notes where it sounds best is hard. So always make sure that you know you have your horn checked out every so often. So subtone's really cool. Basically what's happening is when I play straight tone, it's much brighter. Subtone's much darker, and it's really it's only like the fundamental of the frequencies of that note. So it has this sort of very mellow sound to it. Now there was one other effect I didn't talk about, which was grace notes. Grace notes. So grace notes are really cool. They're really, when you get into that smooth jazz style, grace notes are a key ingredient. And the most common grace note is the flat five. So going up to the five and going down to the four. So going up and down. So I thought I'd play you a recording. So here's the, you can see all of the grace notes here. Multitude of grace notes. Those little tiny things are grace notes. So that's a really big key. So here we have the D blues scale. And so whenever you see an A, you can see that we have the G sharp and the A flat, same note, right around. So up to the A, down to the G. Up to the A, down to the G. Other grace notes too. Any grace note's good. The more the better. So you can see it constantly though. Almost every single time he plays that A, he's preceding it with a grace note. So that's a great effect. Okay, so what I'd like to talk about now is I'd like to get away from the blues. So we've been talking about only blues so far, although this shotgun clearly is not a blues. It's kind of like a one chord kind of thing. So there are a lot of forms that are non-blues forms, and I just wanted to play you a couple of examples of those. Like here's one. So let's analyze this form. Is it a form? What's the form? One, two, three, four. The it's like a one measure form. Now there's actually a little bit of a bridge later, but you never know when that's going to come, and it's really not relevant to trying to play over this part. So how do we play over something that doesn't have form? Because this really doesn't have form. So have you ever had that experience where you're playing on something that's sort of like one chord for a long, long time, and you kind of got to, what do I do? You know, how do I shape my solo? Well, you have to create structure. So you have to impose structure onto it. And it's really not that, you know, rocket science. It's just create a phrase. It could be a one-bar phrase, a two-bar phrase, a four-bar phrase, and stick with that. And that will give the whole thing shape. Even with the blues, getting back to the blues, you know, in terms of getting a handle on that progression, it's really, really good to come up with a phrase, like a one-bar phrase or a two-bar phrase. So if I were to just go back for a sec and do that for you. And you can write out an idea, you know, that's fine. So I'll just try playing a one-bar phrase. That's going to be too fast. I'll do a two-bar. Okay, so now I kind of kept the rhythm the same and changed the notes. But I could keep the notes the same. I could play the same idea for a whole chorus. And it's a really good thing to do that for a couple of reasons. One, it helps you keep your place and know where you are and really hear the form. Another reason is it's great for the rhythm section. So the rest of the band can really lock in to what you're doing. And it's something you might want to do for, you know, a chorus. And then you could get a little looser with your phrasing, but you still want to be phrasing, maybe four-bar phrasing. So the rhythm section can really lock in because there's an expectation about what you're playing. And they can really feed off that. It's also really good for people listening, right? Because they can follow what you're doing. Okay, so getting back to this one bar form. So I was trying to stick to kind of like a two-bar phrase. Okay, so whatever tune you're playing, that you find yourself in a position of playing on whatever tune it is, the first thing you really want to know, in addition to what notes can I play, is what's the form? What's the form of the tune? And if you're doing like jazz, lots of times it's a 32-bar form, but it could be any number of different kinds of forms. So that's something you really want to think about, because if you're improvising over that, you don't want to get lost. And you want to hear where the form is. If you hear where the form, people often say, well, but what do I play? I got the notes, but what do I play? If you're really hearing the form, ideas will come to you. Okay, rhythmically, ideas will come to you. So let's look at another non-blues form. What do we have here? Still like a one bar. One, two, three, four, one. But now we have two chords. Right? So again, just want a phrase. I want to move on to talk about rhythmic conceptions. So we've been talking about blues scale and talking about how all the different ways we can use the blues scale. However, when you get to funk, especially, and funk styles really permeate everything. They certainly permeate a lot of smooth jazz, has a lot of elements of funk in it. The Get Up recording, Play Along, which is a James Brown, a play along to a James Brown song. That is funk. That's like the early funk in the 1960s. James Brown, you know, the king of funk in that early R&B funk feel. So if you listen to the saxophonist who soloed with James Brown, Maceo Parker, you'll hear his playing is extremely sparse and rhythmic. So basically, he's leading with rhythm. In his mind, he's thinking rhythm. He's thinking like a drummer, like a rhythm guitar player, like a bass player. He's not thinking the way we think, right? We think melody. We play single note lines. We play melodies. And so all of our study goes into melodic playing. Jazz players think melody, right? They think about the jazz line, you know, bebop. You see all those eighth notes in the Omnibook, right? But when you listen to Maceo Parker, it's a very, very rhythmic sound. And that's sort of the model for funk playing. So if I were to play back on that groove, what you'll hear is how good it sounds. Just to play simple. Too, but the rhythmic stuff is really what's happening. And you know, so you definitely want to add that to the mix. So you can go into like, you know, the line stuff sometimes, but realize that rhythmic, you know, when I teach jazz players this music and I say, okay, let's play, they'll all go into like bebop. And no, you know, keep it simple, keep it rhythmic. Listen to the rhythm guitar player. So let's check out a little Maceo Parker. And here's a tune he did. So just looking at this, you go, oh my God, this is like so crazy. Rhythmically, it looks like, you know. And so what we're seeing a lot here is, what are we seeing? A lot of syncopation. What kind? Say again, 16th note syncopation. So jazz is pretty much all about eighth note syncopation. Okay, so you have that eighth note coming in on the upbeat. Ba ba zoo ba ba do ba 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 do ba. Here, the beat's usually slower, and it's ba 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 bo ba ba do di da ba bo bo di ba. So you get more subdivisions of the beat. The syncopated 16th notes are your second and fourth 16th notes. So if I just sang those notes, ba, 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 ba. Okay, so Maceo Parker's like a genius when it comes to this stuff. He never really lets go, you know, with a line or anything. It's all about that, and it's like, it's amazing. It's all in the nooks and crannies, all, you know, all in the fine spaces. So this is really an important thing. Now, if you want to get a feel for how to play like this, listen, right? So it's so important to listen to these players, because you can listen to someone talk about this all day long, but until it's coming from within you, then it's really, you know, never gonna happen that much. So if you listen to it a lot, it'll start to come out. So like the whole thing about whether you want to play bebop or you want to play modal jazz or funk, it's so much is a key is listening. It's really a lot like language. So if you think about how you learn to speak English, or whatever your native tongue happens to be. How did you learn to speak it? Well, you didn't have a choice. I mean, that's all you heard all day long, every single day. And it was just constantly, constantly there. And then all of a sudden, you started to speak. So music is really exactly the same. That's not to say, you know, learn the theory, learn, you know, examples of how it should be work. But the more you hear it, the more you get it through osmosis. And you just kind of pick it up, and all of a sudden. And especially things like the nuances, you know, the flavor, the way you phrase, bending notes, all of that. That's like the accent. If you speak a language, but you never really go to the country and listen to the proper accent, you know, it's hard to have the right accent. So the same thing is true with music. So if you like this music or any music, just, you know, just download stuff, go on, you know, YouTube, whatever, and just listen a lot. There's so much stuff out there now. Okay, so that's a little Maceo, and that's a rhythmic approach. So one way to kind of get yourself, to force yourself into this more rhythmic playing, which can be tough and tough to get the idea, is to just take a rhythm. So what I did was I took the rhythm from the beginning of Splashin', kind of. I changed it a little bit, but I took it from that. And I have students, I say, okay, I want you to improvise with this. Okay, so this is your rhythm. You can't play any other rhythm. And this, it's a struggle. It can be a struggle at first, because it's just like trying to make yourself do something that you're not used to doing. So first thing, like, so you could just take a rhythm, write it out for yourself. So let me stick with... You don't need a lot of different notes. So just like pick three or four and just work around those notes. And then you can do something else. Okay, cool. So the next thing I want to talk about is, so I never really said this, but I think it's pretty obvious that with these styles, whether it's smooth jazz or whether it's 50s R&B, a lot gets borrowed from jazz itself. So a lot of the things that, like, if we listen to somebody like Cannonball Adderley, you know, that kind of thing can get borrowed and put over into the funk grooves or whatever. And so that takes us to bebop. So bebop is, what is bebop? Anybody want to disagree with that? Continuous. Okay, so we definitely think of a lot of notes, right? A lot of notes. I think sax players got paid by the note back in those days or something, I'm not sure. So bebop is the music of Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, Sonny Stitt, right? And they were famous for those ultra-fast tempos. But if Charlie Parker plays a ballad and he improvises on it, is it still bebop, or do you have to be there to hear it? No, sorry, that's something else. Is that bebop? If Bird plays like a really slow tune, but he plays like a lot of notes. It's still bebop, right? Because of the notes he's playing and the way he's ordering those notes. So we can talk about bebop as being, you know, that fast music, but we can also talk about bebop as a language. So basically what Byrd did was he came up, well, and not alone, of course, there was a group of them. They came up with this way of playing over chord changes that was completely new and different. You know, up until that point, it was swing. You know, so you had people like Coleman Hawkins and Lester Young and Johnny Hodges. And they were improvising, and it was pretty sophisticated. But then when Byrd and Dizzy Gillespie came along, they just, you know, it just all of a sudden took shape. It got much more, it got much tighter on the chords. And so when we hear bebop played well, we can really hear them carving out those chord changes very explicitly. So here are some lines that are in the style of that. So let me play a few. Play it so you can really hear the line and how they go. Do you kind of get how that relates to Byrd, Charlie Parker? Okay, so I'm going to try playing some of this type of language over a groove so you can kind of hear. Go back to the one I was using here. So you can kind of hear how this works. So this is pretty funk related, so I might start. So far, just blues. How do you play? Yes.
So
go ahead.
This has always been like in my mind, like did Charlie Parker and Dizzy, did they basically like just add a whole bunch of like chromatic notes in there?
Okay. So well. It's true that there's a lot more chromaticism in this language than what came before it, but it's very. I don't like to say scientific, but it's very ordered and structured so that the chromatic passing tones tend to be on the weak parts of the beat. So the way it's structured, like this is over a B minor 7 and kind of an E7 chord. So if you'll notice, like here it gets very chromatic, G sharp, G, F sharp, F, E, E flat, D. On the beat is a G sharp, an F sharp, an E natural, and a D natural. These are all notes in the scale that we use for the B minor chord, the Dorian mode. So it's chromatic, but the chromatic passing tones are on the weak, like in eighth notes, they'd be on the upbeat. Okay, so it's not just that they're playing chromatic. It's that they're connecting the good notes with chromatic passing tones.
Basically on the upbeat
or with 16th notes on the E and the A. And then there's a lot of other things, like they use tensions, like the not, so your chords are 1, 3, 5, 7, and then the tensions are 9, 11, and 13. So they use a lot of tensions, like flat 9, sharp 9, sharp 11, things like this. So it's very, very sophisticated harmonically, much more complex than what the swinger players were doing. It's like a really groundbreaking moment in jazz. When Charlie Parker did what he did, he basically set up whatever was going to come until Coltrane. And then Coltrane did a whole nother thing, and that added a whole nother thing to the mix. So you know, bebop, I can't really say use this scale, use this, use that, because you kind of have to just study bebop, jazz, and theory. You have to learn your chords, you have to learn your scales. But you guys are young, right? So you can do that. No big deal. And you know, practicing solos that are written in this style is really helpful. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about is, I think it's the last thing, is so far I've only talked about playing things that are in the key, okay? Things that are inside the tonality. But we can also play outside the tonality. We can play wrong and it can sound good. So I'll try to cover that kind of quickly for you. So a way that we do that is with pentatonic scales. There are a lot of ways of doing this. This is one. Pentatonic scales are just like the blues scale, except they don't have the flat five. So they have five notes. It's like the black notes on the piano. That's a pentatonic scale. So this is a minor pentatonic scale. So you see one flat three, four flat, five flat seven. No flat five there. So I can take this scale and play with this, and then I can go a half step away and play with the E flat minor pentatonic, even though the key doesn't change. And it can sound good. What I just did then was I was going back and forth, D minor pentatonic, E flat minor pentatonic, D minor pentatonic, E flat minor pentatonic. Okay, so but now what we're looking at now, here I'm cycling, okay, meaning I'm going to move through all 12 keys in some interval. These are half steps. So I'm playing, I come up with some melodic idea, and then I transpose it up a half step or down a half step, and I keep going in that direction. So you see this first one. And just the best thing is just take something as simple as you can. So like, and rest assured, this takes a lot of practice. So if it sounds hard, it is. It takes time, you know, to get to the point where you can do that. And then you try to place it in, you know, a spot. If I change direction, okay. And that time, I also what I did was on the way down, I stopped doing half steps. I was changing in whole steps. So instead of going from like I was skipping one, so I'd be going this one over to this measure. So it's, you can pick different intervals to move the idea through. You guys were great. Thank you very, very much.